Dear participants, very good morning to you all. Welcome to the fifth day of our international e-workshop on issues, challenges and trends in literature and English language teaching. I'm very much happy and feel honored to introduce to you all a great orator, a very socially conscious academician and an activist, Professor S. Prabhakar, Dean, School of English and Foreign Studies, Foreign Language Studies, Mananmaniyam Sundaranar University, Tirunelveli. For half of the audience who participated in the workshop organized by our university, Pondicherry University, Professor S. Prabhakar is a very familiar figure. For the rest of the audience, I wish to introduce Professor S. Prabhakar. Professor S. Prabhakar has almost two decades of academic service. He has been a very, very popular teacher among students and fellow faculty members. He has been a very, very strict research supervisor, and he never compromises with the quality of the dissertations submitted under his supervision. I happen to be an examiner for a few of his, dissertations which were submitted under his supervision, and I could see the quality of research work done under his supervision. And he has been a very active administrator as well. In times of crisis in the academia, he used to assist the administrators, especially the last two vice chancellors. He guided them in a perfect manner, in a proper manner, in times of academic crisis. He has revised, he has reformed a lot of, he has brought in a lot of reforms in the examination system of Mananmaniyam Sundaranar University as a controller of examinations. In addition to these things, he has also authored quite a few important seminal books on subaltern literature, postmodern writings, and Indian writing in English. He has been a resource person for more than 100 seminars, conferences, refresher courses, and other things. So he is the most sought after resource person, I would say. Today, he is going to deliver his lecture on digital humanities. When I called him to invite him for this e-workshop, I told him you can speak on any topic that is close to your heart. Immediately he said, no, I don't want to speak on a topic which I already dealt with. I'll be much more serious if you give me a new area so that I can learn and speak very, 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 resourcefully, and I can also learn several things with regard to the new area. Then he chose digital humanities as a topic for today's discussion, which is a very, very new area, an emerging area. Perhaps I have also listened to quite a number of lectures, a few lectures on digital humanities. But honestly speaking, I would get much more details in a very simplified, lucid manner if Prabhakar speaks on digital humanities today. And the way in which he sums up, the way in which he details the characteristics of digital humanities, the trend set by digital humanities, the paradigm shift which digital humanities effects in the field of humanities and academia, all these things, I'm very, very sure that all of us I along with the audience would be highly benefited by today's lecture, by this morning's lecture by Professor S. Prabhakar. As I already assured you all, there is going to be a very, very brainstorming session, an earthquake in the literary landscape today in the lecture of Professor S. Prabhakar. Very, very happy and elated to invite Professor S. Prabhakar to deliver his lecture on digital humanities. Over to you, Professor Prabhakar.
At the outset, thank you, Professor Marks, for your quite lovely introduction about me. Thank you. The most honorable pro-chancellor of NI University, my well-wisher, my mentor, Professor Perumal Swami sir, the former vice-chancellor of DMI University, Nagaland, my well-wisher again, my good friend, Professor Dunstan, the secretary of MTN College, the organizers of this program, my beloved friend, a Fulbright scholar, an Indo-Sastri fellow, Professor S. Armstrong, Dr. Agit, Dr. Jaypriya from Mother Teresa University, the co-organizer of this program, the hero of this event, my beloved younger brother, Mr. Subbu, Rama Subbu of Mannar Thirumalai Naikar College, learned participants of this e-workshop, my good friend, my long-time associate, Professor T. Marks, and other friends who are wishing me good luck, best wishes, good morning, I say in the chat box, and my dear scholar friends. Good morning once again. Today, the topic that I have chosen to delve on is digital humanities. I would like to design my lecture in this manner. Number one, let me explain what is the importance of this digital technology. Number two, what is humanities? Number three, what do we mean by digital humanities? Number four, is digital humanity is in existence or it is still considered a distant dream? Number five, I would rather discuss how this digital humanities has crept into a praxis, a theory, a kind of practice in English literary studies. And finally, that I would like to touch upon the most important strategy of this digital humanities, macro analysis. So this is how that I have designed my lecture today. Friends, when during this pandemic days, when we were organizing few webinars, e-workshops, and seminars in the digital platform, some of my friends, or many of my friends, they have a very different opinion about these webinars, e-workshops, and other things. They are under the impression that this digital technology has not rather reached the unreached or the underprivileged in the society. And therefore, taking online classes, attending e-workshops, or organizing webinars and seminars in the digital or in the cyberspace To some of my friends, it looks quite ridiculous and also unacademic. But time has come that we need to redefine and we need to rediscover the significance of the cyberspace and the digital portals. Friends, to make you understand the importance of technology and also this digital space, let me draw a parallel between the advent of the printing press and the personal computers. Friends, the advent of the printing press over 500 years ago, it may be described as one of the few major significant events in the history of mankind. In terms of, I would like to rather insist, the greatest impact on literacy. So, the invention of printing press has had its greatest impact on literacy. When the printing press was invented, it provided greater access to information for all and providing the framework for the gradual transformation of social literacy. So I want the participants to remember these two terminologies, these two terms, the greatest impact on literacy and a transformation of social literacy. Marshall McLuhan, a great media theorist in 1962, he claims that the printing press allowed for the democratization of knowledge. Democratizing the knowledge as a higher number of individuals were provided more access to information. So the printing press, it gave access to the general public more information. The printing press technology advanced and demonstrated a drastic rise in adult literacy throughout Europe. With the invention of the printing press, creating nearly identical books of quality at an economical price, at an affordable price, books were now more affordable and available to the people. And Marshall McLuhan, he claims, it is estimated that 1,540 and Haxton Press in England, and by 1,500-1,500, there were 15 to 20 million copies of 30,000 to 35,000 separate publications. Just imagine, within 100 years of this invention of the printing press, by the beginning of 16th century, by 1500, there were 15 to 20 million copies of 35,000 to 35,000 of different publications. So, the printing press, it was an agent of change in terms of the educational practice. It transformed the relationship between the educator and student. All these years, before this printing press, education or knowledge in the form of a script, or there were scriptoriums in churches, and this knowledge, it was the privilege of the clergy, it was the privilege of the bourgeois, the rich class. But the printing press has democratized, has revolutionized, and has liberalized this education, and it transformed the relationship between education and the student, between the educator and the student. Einstein in 1979, he claimed, previous relations between the masters and disciples were altered. Students who took full advantage of technical text, which served as silent instructors. So books, right, this is a new technology in the 16th century. And books replaced the masters. Books replaced the educators, and books remain the silent instructors. Young Minds provided with the updated editions, especially of mathematical texts, began to surpass not only their elders, but the wisdom of ancient as well. So book as a technology, printing press as a technology, transformed the paces of education, the paces of learning, and the paces of formation of knowledge. And again, this printing press, and before this printing press, it was only Latin and Greek. And after the advent of printing press across Europe and say in Asia, the regional languages gained importance. People from their oral tradition, they started trying their hands by printing the materials, the knowledge in regional languages. And friends, this is a scientific survey, and this is a scientific study which claims that printing press has made most of the liturgical languages such as Greek and Latin extinct by giving importance or by gaining significance over the regional languages. So this printing press and the technology, with the invention of this printing press, we would say the most immediate effect was the output of a greater number of books, a more economical cost of the general public. So this is the point that I would like to highlight with the printing press. The immediate effect was the output, that the outcome, the output of a greater number of books. The greater number of books, the greater amount of knowledge one is transforming, and at an economical cost to the general public. Over the longer term, books would not only increase literacy rates due to the increased availability and access, but it also helped begin the spread of political and religious movements within Europe. So we can simply say the printing press, with the publication of books, with the formation of new knowledge system, with the easy access to knowledge, with easy access to a democratized form of knowledge, with a revolutionized form of knowledge, with an economical form of knowledge, this printing press, it has spread in new political and religious ideologies within Europe and across the world. So it is without a doubt, the printing press has had an impact on societal literacy. But I still keep repeating this word, the social literacy, and printing press has had a greater impact on the transformation of knowledge, but the transmission of information. And say the printing press has liberalized, democratized, revolutionized the forms of knowledge. Friends, just like a printing press, now currently we are experiencing a similar monumental shift. It is not just a paradigm shift. It is not just an ideological shift. It is not just a shift of ambition. It is a monumental shift that we have come across in the field of education and also in the field of the construction of knowledge in a new form of technology with the internet, with online. Hopefully, we can learn from the implementation of the printing press and in conjunction with the internet, beneficially understand the growth, development, and impact on literacy. So, my first part, that I have drawn a parallel between the printing press and the advent of the personal computers, the personal computers and internet. Now, I request the admin to show my slides to the participants.
Priya,
And friends, as a knowledge, knowledge as an empowerment, as a tool of empowerment. Right in the first slide that I have given, and many people, the moment they say computers, the moment they say digital, the moment they say online, they have their own apprehension. They have their own fear. Online education, online media, and all these things, people, they would simply say it is quite unreachable to the underprivileged section of the society. And for them, that I have my slides, that slides, and which would rather, I believe, clarify most of their congenital doubts over technology. 1960s, it is the era of the personal computers. Do you know what is the slogan of this 1960s? And when this personal computers was invented or introduced, and it has got a Marxist maxim. And in 1960s, the digital slogan is power to the people. And when the personal computer was introduced, when the personal computer was liberalized, and when it was rather, sold in the market to be a common man's commodity, in 1960s, the very first advertisement for the personal computer is, which reads, power. Power to the people. And we are empowering people with this gadget. We are empowering people with a new form of knowledge. And knowledge in electronic media, knowledge in digital media. Knowledge has been no more the privilege of the rich. And we are liberalizing, democratizing this knowledge by empowering ordinary people by introducing these personal computers. So this is called the Power to the People Literacy Mission. So what is this personal computers? And personal computers, just like your literacy mission, just like adult literacy mission, this is a universal literacy mission with a slogan, Power to the People. Adam Kirsch, one of the proponents of these digital humanities, he says, knowledge has always been produced and accessed in ways that are fundamentally distributed. Right? Why knowledge? Right? What is the purpose of creation of knowledge? The purpose of any knowledge, the objective of knowledge is to be distributed. Any information formed has to be disseminated. Any knowledge formed has to be transformed. So knowledge has a purpose. Knowledge has an objective. Knowledge has a system. It has an objective that it has to be disseminated and distributed. And this knowledge is, say, mostly, it is recognized only through the medium that it is conveyed. It was through the scripts. It was through oral medium. Later, it was through the palm leaves. Then the paper. And now it is the digital, the cyber medium, the electronic medium. So knowledge has always been produced and accessed in ways that are fundamentally distributed. Matthew Kirschenbaum, and he is one of the greatest proponents of this digital humanities in the field of English literary studies. And even the very title of his article, What is Digital Humanities Doing in English Classrooms? And he says, this is really quite interesting to the participant and also to the educators. The construction of digital humanities increasingly serves to focus the anxiety and even an outrage of individual scholars over their lack of agency and the turmoil in the institutions and professions. It is quite interesting. And if you read it, if you break the sentence, and if you read it right in parts, that you will understand the problem and the solution that Kirschenbaum, he suggests in this digital humanities. Like, what is this digital humanities doing in the English department? In fact, an assistant professor in the University of London, he was rather terminated. This has got an allusion. He was terminated from service for not engaging classes properly. And all the time that he was engaging himself in online classes, and he was making use of this digital portal to teach. And but when his when his career was assessed for promotion, and the traditional conservative teachers and academicians and administrators, they said that he was not up to the mark and he was eliminated from a service. And Kirshenbaum, he says, even if your institution, even if your agency, even if your professional organizations, they do not cope up, they do not understand what you have been doing, what you have been educating, what you have been transforming, right, there comes quite handy the help from this digital humanities that you can, right, you can very well advocate, you can very well spread, you can very well transmit and transform your knowledge to the people. So, my dear friends, digital era, our digital world, our digital gadgets are, right, as we misconceive, as we misunderstand, are not a costly affair. It is not a sophisticated instrument. It is not meant only for the aristocrats. I will show you the statistics later. There, from there, that you will understand. So, as what printing press has done in Europe and in the world for the last 500 years, digital space, electronic space, and these digital gadgets are doing in the last 50 years. I would say all the revolutions brought by brought after this printing press for the last 500 years has been achieved by this digital medium within 50 years. My slide number 2. But I said knowledge trust, where I talk about the dissemination of knowledge. There I talked about the invention of this printing press in 1440. And later, this Gutenberg's printing press, how it has been transformed to the Haxton's printing press in England, and how the printing press has been adopted. The technology has been adopted in various parts of the world, and within, and how this printing press, this technology can be compared with an era of enlightenment with the advent of these computers, with the advent of these personal computers after 1960s. Dear participants, the left margin, I have given the books, the title of the books, which I have referred for my lectures. And these are the seminal textbooks for your for the newly formed critical theory, this digital humanities. And say my slide number 3, I talked about the knowledge liberalized. And this is rather the book that I have quoted here is Democracy and Education. This is by John Dewey. This knowledge is liberalized. The common feature of liberal humanism, say during this Renaissance and after the fall of Constantinople and after the emergence of Renaissance and this during this Elizabethan period in England, the common feature of this liberal humanism is freedom. By freedom, that we don't mean any political freedom. It is not just associated with any supernatural things. And by freedom, that we mean the freedom of knowledge, right? The freedom of knowledge. And quite interestingly, I have another anecdote to narrate. That when this Apple as a name was suggested to the incorporatory, to the company, to the computer company, and why did they call it Apple? Because Apple is is the form of knowledge. It is the fruit of knowledge. And that is why they called the company Apple. And Apple, that in fact, even off of the apple is bitten. And it has already been tasted. The knowledge has already been tasted. So that is how they wanted to liberalize knowledge through a newly invented gadget. And this liberal humanism, he talks about the freedom of knowledge. And this liberal humanism, say, and even today that we are living in a new form of humanism. And this humanism, and this is rather a liberalization of knowledge, the democratization of knowledge, the dissemination of information, and what Alvin Toffler and McLuhan would call the explosion of information. It is, and we are living in a knowledge era, the era of information, the era of explosion of information. And with this exploration of information, and we believe that this society, the contemporary society, it believes that our observation can be explained by human investigation and thought. And we want to know the unknown, and we want to create the uncreated. We always want to have a rational faculty, and we want to be self-dependent. And self-dependence, and this online portal, and this electronic devices mediated information and education, they would rather ensure absolute freedom of a humankind. And now we have the responsibility to give meaning and shape to our lives through this medium, through this electronic medium. Friends, and this is the next slide, slide number five, right, slide number four, that I reiterate my point that technology, it changes the world. That the technology changes the world. Friends, the intellectual history of the West, before 1950, it was linguistic in turn. And after 1950, after the Second World War, it was cultural in turn. And after 1990, it is computational. It is digital and technological in turn. And let us pursue that this digital humanities, that I would just like to explain. Now I will try to explain what is this digital humanities as a critical theory, as a newly founded knowledge system. And this digital humanities, basically, the word, it has two parts. Number one, digital; two, humanities. So digital, if it is used as an adjective, right? Digital as an adjective, which means computational, right? Computational. And humanities, Encyclopedia Britannica, and also any dictionary would say that it is a branch of knowledge, humanities. It is a branch of knowledge that concern themselves with human beings and their culture, or with analytic and critical methods of inquiry derived from an appreciation of human values and of the unique ability of the human spirit to express itself. And we can say this humanities is an academic discipline. It is different from the natural and physical sciences. That in the sense that in the natural and physical sciences, that we have the computational strategies to prove or to, right, to assess the truth which has been explained. And similarly, in humanities, after 1990s, that we are introducing computational technologies. We are introducing the logical and mathematical cohesion, the mathematical understanding, right, a scientific understanding to interpret a text. to interpret the discipline called humanities. Therefore, digital, if it is rather an adjective, it is a computational, and the computational methods suggested or recommended in the branch of humanities, which includes literature and arts. Number two, that we are talking about the digitality. Right? By digitality, this Niels Bregger, right, and there are many associations, ALLHC and University of Cambridge, right, Cambridge Humanities Center right from 1960s, and most of the Western universities, they have this digital humanities center where they are perceiving the discipline humanities from a digital perspective, from the perspective of computational techniques or computational technologies. When we talk about the digitality, this digital humanities, as Niels Bregger claims, it is in the 21st century. The digital material is a driving force, and it is important to stress that there is an interplay between the digital and the humanities. It is not regarded as a one-way traffic or as a one-way thing, which is deterministic, which determines its logic from digital to humanities. Instead, this digital humanities is understood a dialectic interplay. It is both computational and humanities. It is a dialectical interplay between the digital technology and the branches of a discipline, the branches of the humanities. It is an interplay between or shaping and reshaping between the digital and the humanities. And the two disciplines are interdependent. And humanities at present is dependent of this digital technology. And digital technology has had its impact on literature, its impact on a culture, its impact on arts. And now we think only in terms of electronics. And you are surprised. I give you the statistics. This is the next slide number 5. And this is to the conservative school of thought. And people, they say, the students cannot be reached online. The students do not have adequate facilities to reach or to encounter this digital platform.
Please, Brabhanan. Yes, go ahead.
And I received a call and the whole setting has been changed.
Okay.
Am I visible now? Okay. The number of if you have the permission to zoom this slide to the maximum, I think the audience, the participants will be get convinced. Friends, of the 10 top countries, of the 10 top countries of the numbers of mobile phone users, of the 10 top countries, 6 are from Asia. It is number 1 is China. The connection of mobile phone users per 100 in China is 114. 100 people in China have 114 connections. Number 2 is India. 100 people having 104 connections. So this is the statistics in 2019. The top 10 countries, China, India, Indonesia, Bangladesh, Pakistan, and Japan are from Asia. And quite surprisingly, United States has come only in the fourth place. Russia in the sixth place. Just imagine, in India, we have 114 connections per 100, says the 2019 statistics. We are number two country of in the numbers of mobile phone users in the world. My next slide. My slide number, please go to slide number 6. It also reveals a surprising fact to you. It is the statistics of the worldwide internet users. I just request the admin to zoom it again, as done to the previous slide. Just imagine. So this is again a statistics in 2019. The world population. That in 2019, the world population, 7.75 billion people are using the internet connection. Of the worldwide users, imagine 53% of the total population living in this globe, living on this planet, are using internet connection. And of the 53% users in the world, 47% are from the developing world. We know that India is a developing country, where we have 104 connections per 100 people. 104 mobile users using 47% of the internet connectivity in the developing world. And users in the developed world, the developed nations, it is 86%. And the internet users by region. In Africa, it is 28. In America, it is 77. In Arab, it is 51. And in Asia and Pacific, Asia-Pacific region, which includes Asia, Australia, New Zealand, and other Pacific region, it is 48.4, which means one out of every two is making use of internet, is making use of mobile phone, and making use of this worldwide internet. And the response in the chat box says, eye-opening. And the response says, in new statistics, quite encouraging. 104 out of 100 are making use of mobile phones with internet connectivity. So, my dear friends, it is no more a new technology. It is no more a new critical insight. It is no more a new digital platform. It is no more the privilege of the privileged, or the privilege of the bourgeois, the privilege of the sophisticated aristocratic society. The statistics says this has become a common man, that this has become a common man's gadget. As the slogan reads, power to the people. We are tasting the fruit of knowledge happily. And knowledge has been revolutionized, knowledge has been democratized, and knowledge has been liberalized. And we are making use of this online medium, we are making use of these electronic gadgets, not as people who have the private ownership of knowledge. We are sharing the knowledge. We are disseminating the knowledge. And even this workshop during this pandemic period on Sunday at 11 o'clock, we are transforming knowledge. We are sharing the knowledge through this electronic medium. So these two slides, I would say, might even convince people with different opinions, with alternate ideology, with other forms of thoughts who claim that mobile phones are, we don't have mobile phones or we don't have connectivity. 50% of the total population are making use of this internet. And in India, it is 104 per 100. And we are the second largest, the second largest in terms of the mobile users in the world. And now go to my next slide, the digitization of knowledge. Now it is inevitable. As books were printed, now knowledge has to be digitized. And I congratulate MTN College. I place on record my heartfelt appreciation to University of Madras and Mother Teresa University and whoever gets associated with this e-workshop. We are digitizing our knowledge. We are democratizing our knowledge. And this digitization of this knowledge through this network technologies, including the World Wide Web and the increasing ease with which the non-textual files, such as images, sounds, and these moving images. Just imagine that now that we are making use of Zoom, and during this lockdown 1.0, my friends and me, my friends, Professor Armstrong, Professor Marks, and my other elder and younger friends, we wanted to have a similar workshop. And we had a similar workshop with a limited technology. It was lockdown 1.0. There was no shop open. And with the available technologies, we had our first ever workshop on critical theories. And I know my friends were all apprehensive. My friends were quite doubtful. And I had to lift the confidence of my friends. I had to give them pep talk. I had to go to the extent of nagging all my friends to prepare their e-content, to prepare their e-lecture. And they followed the technology. And with the technology, they were able to transform the images, the moving images, the videos as text. Professor Armstrong was on video. Professor Marx was on as a moving image. Me as a moving text. And this was all possible only when we are ready to digitize our knowledge. And similarly, and this transformation of these sounds, moving images could be created and shared, led to a step change in the engagement of arts and humanities with digital technologies. And this digitization programs is to promote digital editions. Now we are promoting these digital editions, archives of text. It was in the oral tradition. Later, it was the property of the monastery, and it was the property of the privileged rich class. Knowledge in any form, knowledge in the form of a palm leaf, knowledge in the form of oral tradition, knowledge in the form of a sculpture, knowledge in the form of a script. And it was a property of a scriptorium. It was a property of a monastery. It was a property of an episcopal society, a clergy. But now knowledge has been democratized, unimaginable horizon of spheres. And this digitization programs He promoted this edition, this promoted the spread or the dissemination of knowledge. And again, the commercial organizations such as Google, they also began to digitize large parts of the Western cultural heritage. Now this is rather a very common usage that we have. That why don't you Google it? At the moment that we say, what is the meaning of this word? Immediately somebody would say, why don't you Google it? And I would rather request participants to Google this digital humanities to understand it better. And apparently, Jerome McGill, right, Macken, in his New Republic of Letters, published by Harvard University Press in 2014, he asserts that the whole of our cultural inheritance, this is very, very important, the whole of our cultural inheritance has to be, this is the word that we are making use of, curation of knowledge, recurated, but recurated and re-edited in digital forms and in institutional structures. But what does this digitization of knowledge do? This digitization of knowledge, it curates, it recurates the culture, and it also keeps all forms of knowledge as an institutional structure. My dear friends, we all belong to digital humanities. If you don't belong to this digital humanities now, the next moment, tomorrow, or day after tomorrow, that you will be one. This is the popular maxim the digital humanist would ever say. And they also make a lot of propaganda. Digital humanities, this agenda 1.0, like lockdown 4.0, 5.0, or unlock 1.0, they also have their manifesto. Like everything is rather modeled on this manifesto, or the manifesto, the Marxist, this communist manifesto. Similarly, they also have a manifesto, the digital community manifesto. This 2.0 is released, and now they are rather thinking of releasing 3.0. And this origin and development of this digital humanities. But I think that I have spoken much on this origin and development of this digital humanities. And there are various organizations, and it was with the publication of this Blackwell Companion to the Digital Humanities. And this is the book that I have given the left origin. And it is a recent development only after 2004. And there is an association, ALLCH and ACH, and which means the Alliance of Digital Humanities Organization. This is ADHO, formed in 2005. And this Digital Humanities Conference in 2006. And with the adoption of the term Digital Humanities, scholars working in the field have moved well beyond considering methods by which, very, very important. Now I'm coming to the last part of my lecture, how literature can be interpreted with the knowledge system of this digital humanities. Right. And it is increasingly important that the digital humanities scholars working in the field have moved well beyond considering methods by which any primary materials of humanities, it could be an artifact, it could be a stone carving, it could be literature, it could be a poem, and materials of humanities, research can be analyzed, it can be done and disseminated in digital form, right? In a digital form. So the knowledge in digital form. So to be very simple, the prime objective of digital humanities is to keep knowledge in digital form. As books keep the knowledges, right, the system of knowledge, now it is the digital media. And increasingly important element of the digital humanities has changed our view of the humanities, and conversely, the insights on the digital age as authenticity, memory, identity, and authority And this has led to engagement with media and cultural literacy. And I have given the definition and characterization of this digital humanities. And also I have talked about the next slide, computing and culture. But I think that I have taken much more time. Let me move to digitizing English. And I think if I could speak on the rest of the slides, and there are many queries in the chat box, and many people, they are still not convinced with the digital forms of knowledge, and many still believe that this digital era, this digitization of knowledge, is only the privilege of the rich, not the poor. Okay, digitizing English. Matthew G. Kirschenbaum, in his article, What is Digital Humanities and What It Is Doing in the English Departments, he talks about the technology of digital humanities. And he says, text has been for the most tractable data. Now, we are considering the text, the book, as a data type for computers to manipulate. That we can manipulate the book. We can dissect the book. We can make all sorts of dissection of the text by making use of the computational technology. And when I was doing right, and this is rather, and I must say thank you to Marx and for rather reducing my age. And I have had 3 decades of teaching experience. And when I was doing my research, my MPhil, say long back in 1980s, right, 1980s, and there was always a wonder in our research classrooms. People say there is a PhD research on the use of the definite article "the" in Virginia Woolf. I think that there was a PhD on the use of the definite article "the" in Virginia Woolf. And this was one of the most the most sought after or the most discussed PhD thesis in our classroom. And the teachers who are interested in language studies, the teachers who give importance to structuralism, formalism, and to this kind of close reading. Now I'm coming to the literature part of it, to the close analysis of the text, to the close reading of the text, they would always talk about the use of preposition, the use of adjectives, the use of articles in the particular text. My dear friends, this digitization of knowledge has revolutionized. You go to the word count and you can simply find that you take a book as a text and you go to the word count and you can simply find how many words are there. You don't have to count. You simply give the program word count of the text. It will summarize how many words are there. And you just go to control find and control next, and it tells you how many times the articles there are used in the particular text. All these things are made quite simple and easy. And say another thing that I would say, the use of the image blood in Macbeth, and there is a computational technology used, and there is an article written on Shakespeare, the use of blood in the entire Shakespeare's text. And they have made Shakespeare as a digital data, and from there that they read, they understand how many times Shakespeare has used the image of eagle in his place, the image of blood in his place, and from there they can very well understand from this microscopic analysis, from this micro analysis, they can very well understand the essence of the age, the spirit of the age, and the spirit of Shakespeare, and the spirit of any literature. So text has been converted into, the text has been converted into data. And Matthew Kirschenbaum, he talks about the openness of English and the hypertext, and how text can be converted into hypertext, and how hypertext gives you a new kind of interpretation. This new kind of interpretation, we call it macro analysis in digital humanities. Friends, there are two aspects in digital humanities. One, the language aspect. Number two, the literary aspect. The literary aspect, this digital humanities as an episteme, as a system of knowledge, as a critical theory. And similarly, digital humanities or the gadgets are used to teach English as a second language, to teach or to innovate various methodologies to teach English. And I would prefer, that is one aspect, and I prefer to speak on this digital humanities as an episteme, as a critical theory, as a newly founded critical theory, how it perceives text, and with the approach called macro analysis. Right? This macro analysis is the next, right, the next thing that I would like to talk about. And friends, please go to my slides where I have talked about Shakespeare. Slide number 16 and 17. If I say, of all the others, Shakespeare is the most sought after, people may not believe me. But now I can validate my statement. Right? I want the admin to rather zoom this slide. Right? Make it say a text with file. Right? And you see, this is the top 100. That it is the top the hits. Right. Number one, it is the popularity of the person. Right, the next slide, the popularity. The previous one. Okay, I would like to even. Speak right. Okay, keep it. And of say this is rather the number 69 is the million hits, million right. This is rather the digit in the right number is the hits by millions. And of the most of the top 100 searches in the internet, of the top 100 popular searches in internet, Shakespeare is the only author who rather figures in 59th position. Right, in the left-hand side that you have got the number. The 59th position, it is a Shakespeare. And the hits, it is rather measured. It is measured by the number of hits, 67 million people, they searched Shakespeare's homepage. Or Shakespeare, the materials relevant to Shakespeare. And then, so this is how the popularity of an author can be measured. And this statement can very well be validated by using a computational technology. You go to my next slide, the search by author. Right, search by author. And here, the top, right, here the popular top 10 authors. Right, where you can see 57 most popular authors. This is from April 2013 to till date. Number one is William Shakespeare. Number two, Emily Dickinson. And we are happy that Rabindranath Tagore, he figures in this list number 8. Friends, this is not a statement made out of emotion. This is not a statement made out of mere sentiments. This is a statement. This can easily be validated. This can be measured. This can be checked, rechecked. And from here that we understand that William Shakespeare, that of all the writers written in all languages, William Shakespeare is the most sought after author in this universe till date. So this is how that statistics can be arrived at. And now you go to my previous slide, slide number 12, where I talk about the macro analysis and distant reading of digital humanities. So this distant reading, this is a policy. this is a theory advocated by Moratti, and this distant reading is against close reading. And should we read all the text? Right? Is it possible for a human to read all the text published to understand all the to encounter all forms of knowledges published in the form of books? It is not possible. But nowadays, after this digitization of knowledge, that it is easy for one to read almost all at all forms of knowledge for which he is specifically searching for. For example, if I want to read, if I want to understand the strategy of the demography, the strategy of the demography of this coronavirus, the coronavirus mortality and the demography, the mortality and demography of a coronavirus, I don't have to rather read all the text. I can simply give it as a menu in my search bar, as a keyword in my search bar, and I can understand what is the demography of this coronavirus mortality, and I can easily find out that there is no straightforward analysis. There is no straightforward solution to the demography related to the coronavirus mortality. If I want to read something on the democratic sentiments during this Puritan age, I can give it as a key term and I can read it. Right? I can read it. And this is what digital humanities suggest about the macro analysis and distant reading. And this distant reading, mind you, my dear participants, this is a collaborative reading. That a collaborative reading, now that you are engaging yourself in a distant reading of a text, when I am giving a lecture, and we are in the form of a collaboration. We are collaborating with each other to learn. And you can share your views. And I could very well see it in the chat box. You are sharing your views, you are making your postings, you are sharing your comments, and that makes me alter my lecture. And say, this is rather a collaborative technique. This is rather that we are making a collaborative text by making it as a distant reading. So digital humanities does not like the formalist and structuralist recommend, or the new criticism recommend the close reading of the text. This is rather as minimize and maximize in computers. This is rather the maximization of knowledge. The distant reading technique propounded by the macro analysis theory of Moratti of digital humanities. So as a theory, this distant reading, Moratti, he advocates the, and you can also rather maximize this slide. Some of the participants says they could not rather see this. And this distant reading, it understands literature not by studying a particular text, very, very important, not by studying the particular text, but by aggregating and analyzing massive amount of data. Right? By analyzing the massive amount of data. For example, that you can simply search for a religion. That religion as a text in the writers, the Renaissance writers. And it will come as a form of knowledge, because many have already done researches on that topic. And you can also contribute. You can also contribute to the collaborative research. And this is how this reading becomes a macro analysis. And it is not a micro reading. It is not a close reading, which this digital humanities talks about. It talks about the distant reading. It talks about the collaborative reading, where I can collaborate with my listener, where I can collaborate with the other stakeholders of knowledge, and we can read together. And it makes a scientific analysis. And we are converting this text into a big data. And Moratti, he is of the opinion that this reading of the representative canonical text into a sample size, that will rather change the literary trend of the age. That we can subvert through this technical or through these technological inputs, that we can very well subvert all the knowledge forms. And to understand literature, Moratti, he argues that we must stop reading and change our strategy to analyze the data. That we must stop reading as in the form of the traditional close reading of the text. That I don't, dear participants, I don't advocate, I don't simply claim that digital humanities is only, that is the only solution, is the only scope for reading text. No. This also provides a tool to interpret, a tool to understand. This is the most contemporaneous critical insight from that which provides a tool to understand a text. And the understanding of the text in this digital humanities, the episteme, the knowledge system that the digital humanities, it recommends to understand a literary text or a text in the humanities is a macro analysis. More informations, right? It is rather the convergence of data, the convergence of more and more information to a specific branch of knowledge, and through this computational technology that we can understand this. Then what are the advantages of this digital humanities? But I have two more slides to go. The advantages of this digital humanities, it examines outside forces affecting writers as a methodological strategy. We have text in PDF forms, we have hypertext, we have e-text, and therefore we can simply say control find, we can search for the words, we can very well go to the quote. We don't have to there was a time that I had thesaurus, I had the dictionary of quotations, I had dictionaries and all these things. But now the printing technology is replaced with the digital technology. There is no need for a thesaurus. There is no need for quotable quotes. There is no need for any printed dictionary. And we can very well go specifically to the term by using a computer, right? By using a e-text, by using a e-dictionary. And similarly, the text or the work of art in the form of hypertext can easily be approached as a hypertext, and the linguistic part of it can easily be analyzed, and similarly the literary part of it. And number two, it challenges your common sense. Common sense, right? And I told you, most of my friends, that they were against webinars, and fellow scholars, my fellow teachers, who have had 30 years of experience like me, and who are on the verge of retirement, they simply say this is something impossible. Right? Online classes or this hypertext are impossible. That we are here to make the impossible possible by understanding with the right amount of knowledge. And it challenges your common sense, which has been historically constructed saying that this gadget is the privilege of the rich. It is no more the privilege of the rich. So this digital humanities, it challenges common sense ideas by taking the maximum samples. Number three, it rather recommends the broad generalities like genres, trends, themes, and styles. That we can very well compare the themes. This is just like making track changes. You can very well keep two texts together on the screen. You can track your changes as we are tracking the changes in the Word documents, we can highlight, we can track changes, and we can compare. And if you give the baseline, this is just for fun, and don't take it very seriously. If you give T.S. Eliot's baseline, and if you are applying plagiarism, and any plagiarism software would say baseline has got 100% plagiarism, because Westland T.S. Eliot made use of the canonical statements used elsewhere in the canonical text. And we can very well find out from where T.S. Eliot has taken this particular text. And we can explore reaction against literary and plural trends. And we can better question the canons and gender and equality, ethnicity, nationality, they play and impact here, and decoding things that we literally can't see otherwise. Right? All these years that we could not see the other part of encryption of messages. Every text is a message encoded. Every text is a message encrypted. We did not understand what was the codex and what was the code. What was the logic behind encrypting these messages as a text? But now with the computational technology, we can very well understand the codex. We can very well understand what was the methodology that he used in encrypting messages. I happened to read the book by T.S. Eliot, The Composition of Four Quartets. And in that book, T.S. Eliot has very vividly given how did he write the poem, The Four Quartets? How did he change those words? And what was the first sentence that he wrote? Then how did he make alterations? And it was all about the composition of four quartets. But now we can very well understand the composition. We can very well understand the technique behind the literary composition, the technique behind a literary creation. But at the same time, computer, my dear friends, cannot do anything on its own. It is only an artificial intelligence. You need to make your natural intelligence, and you need to seek the support of this artificial intelligence to understand. And I could see it in the many questions in the chat box. Where has gone the human intelligence? Human intelligence is very much there. The natural intelligence is supported by artificial intelligence. It is only an additive. It is not a substitute. It is an additive to your natural intelligence. Your natural intelligence is duly supported by this artificial intelligence. You cannot just dismiss this artificial intelligence. This is the time that you need to develop your AI, your artificial intelligence, to claim or to say that you are very much existing, that you are very much existing in the contemporary world. And if you say that you are alive, you need to have this artificial intelligence to your support. And this digital humanities is not everything. It too has its own limitation. My next slides. My dear friends, not all texts are digitized. We need to digitize all text. And all the commercial forms, Google, all the commercial websites, they would rather keep, again, this digitization as a property of their own. And if you could rather access, and they deny access to your knowledge, they would say that you need to pay or you need to subscribe. And without subscription, that we can download books, we can download text. And if books are downloaded, if books as a system of knowledge are downloaded without paying, without making any payment, just look at the irony. It is called piracy. It is called pirated knowledge. And you are supposed not to keep this pirated knowledge system in your computer or in your mobile. But not all texts are digitized. not all texts are digitized for the uses for the commoners, the use of commoners, but almost all texts are digitized. This is number one limitation. Number two, that we have to maintain an interpretive insights at individual level. That you cannot, don't please dismiss the use of gadgets. Don't please dismiss this digital humanities, this computational technology as the technology of the scientist, as the technology of the government. You have installed Arogya Sethu app in your system to know whether you are running into any risk. When you can order your food through Zomato, through Uber, when you can hire a taxi through Ola, through Uber, you can also have an access to knowledge through this mobile medium, through this digital medium. And we need to have an interpretive insight. We need to have a new form of an insight to understand this digital humanities. Please, please, please don't ever dismiss the use of digital, the use of digital medium in transformation of knowledge, in transmission of information, in maintenance of knowledge, in rather making this knowledge as a system. And number three, it is rather macro, right? It is macro finding info. But still, we need the imagination of a scholar. That in fact, a computer cannot do anything on its own. This is rather a misnomer, and this is a misunderstanding. If I am good at making use of computers, my computers will abide. My computers will rather obey to my wishes, to my technology. And you need to know the technology. And right, I am keeping myself always updated. And I could say that I am a technocrat. I could say that I am a techno-savvy. And therefore that I keep myself updated even at this age, even crossing 50 or 55, that I keep myself updated with new forms of information, with new forms of technology. I never get myself satisfied with what I know. I need to improve myself. And therefore, that I accept, right? I accept new forms of knowledge, new systems of knowledge, new mediums of knowledge. And it is all the imagination of a scholar. Here comes the human intervention. You need to have your own imagination to make use of the computer. Just imagine when movie, right? say the fourth wave, Marcel McLuhan, right? Say Alvin Toffler and also McLuhan says, then came the cinema. Medium in the book, medium as the message, or medium as the massage. Marcel McLuhan, he claims, then came the cinema. And the cinema changed everything. It was not cinema, it was kinema. It was kinesis. It was the moving image. People thought the moving images could not be captured. And with the movie camera, moving images were captured, and movies and films and this kinema, later called cinema, it rather toppled the entire revolution, the entire information, right, the revolutionary information of the world. And similarly, can you ever imagine, this was like my Badala Bairavi, this was like my old movies, where a wizard would be making use of a gadget and he could find out where is the prince or where is the princess. And in the gadget that we could see, the prince or the princess dancing. And we all thought that it was wild imagination. Now we are making use of, right? I could share my slides, I could share my image, and you could share your views. And all these things are rather a collaborative technologies. And here we are making use of this digital technology as a collaborative forms of knowledge. Friends, there is again a danger of quantification as being ends in itself and problematic to make. There is always a problem. We must be very careful when we are making generalizations about a text. Right? And with this new form of knowledge, we tend to generalize facts. And there is again this danger. And people, they always claim this is a knowledge which has already been existing, and digital humanities does not bring any new knowledge. So these are the limitations. And to sum up my last slide, what is this digital humanities? I would say knowledge is power. And knowledge shared is power multiplied. I repeat, knowledge is power. Any critical theory, the Frankfurt School of Thought believes, emancipates, empowers, and liberates human being from slavery. Any critical theory, any new critical insight is a new form of knowledge that revolutionizes, that liberates, that democratizes, that emancipates, and that rather makes one, that frees one from slavery. And knowledge is power, and knowledge shared is power multiplied. In brief, one can understand that digital humanities as a praxis, as a social practice, is a public form of scholarship. But what is this digital humanities? It encourages the public form of scholarship, power to people. And this public form of scholarship that promotes collaboration with digital technology and social undertaking. Number two, the personal computing, the personal computer, your mobile phone, right? Your mobile phone, your PC, your laptop, your tablet, right? Your tablet and all your gadgets, right? All your gadgets seems to have, right? They are creating a counterculture, right? And in the beginning, they said, this is Sunday. I prefer to speak on Sunday because Sunday is not a Sabbath, and Sunday and today, right, in the, after this pandemic, every day is a Sunday. And therefore, I prefer this Sunday to speak, and it is creating a counterculture, which may have promoted, this is the point that I would like everyone to remember, we have a new class. This class is called informational class. Just like working class, just like a capitalist class, just like bourgeois class, we belong to a new class, a new system. This class is called informational class. You are a member of this informational class, and we are all working for the welfare, the welfare of the working class. And we are all at the warfare of this working class by making computers available to the masses. 47% in developing nations. 104 per every 100 holding a mobile phone in India. And we, the informational class, are at warfare, and we are working for the, we are working for the welfare of the common masses, and we want to make computers available to all. That is the reason the government of Tamil Nadu has given free laptops to their students doing undergraduate courses. They are equipping, they are equipping them with this gadget and making this informational class more informative. And computers are only able to be used, people thought, only in the big government offices or in universities or in big corporations. All the 400 participants today are using computers. You are capturing moving images. You are capturing my audio. You are watching the slides shared, and we are making use of online platform. We are making use of all the possible plugin interfaces in Zoom. We are making use of Google Meet, WebEx, Codex, and Google Classrooms and all. And this has become order of the day, which has come to stay. And this digital humanities, the invention of, with the invention of our personal computers, it changed the human hermeneutics. It changed the human perception of the acquisition of knowledge. And I would say interpretation of a knowledge, which is usually more personal and anonymous, has now become more social. Now it is a collaborative, distant reading. We are combining together. You and me are combining together to form a new knowledge, a new form of knowledge. It is no more an individual entity. It is no more my individual property. We collaborate, we associate, and through internet, we keep ourselves connected. That we are connected with each other. And digital humanities encourages the knowledge of connection. And this interpretation, which has come in the social media, that encourages group participation as well. And we call this digital humanities a collaborative movement, where we, right, you see, you are raising your hands, you are giving your responses in the chat, you are asking questions. When I'm giving lectures, you are asking questions, and some of the questions we answer simultaneously. I'm clarifying your doubts. All these things are possible only with this computational technology, with this digital platform. So this digital platform, it creates a counterculture. It liberalizes education. It democratizes education. It revolutionizes your understanding. It revolutionizes a comprehension. It rather democratizes all forms of knowledge. To conclude, I would say, digital humanities, it encourages both close reading and distance reading. And it socializes the network topology. We call it a network topology as opposed to your hierarchy. So, my dear participants, digital humanities is not a hierarchical strategy. It is a subverting strategy, which takes technology to the masses, which helps the general, which helps the general public, which helps ordinary people to gain knowledge. And with this, I would like to conclude by summing up what I have spoken earlier. Number one, I correlated the computational technology with printing press. Number two, I explained what is this computational technology and what is this digital humanities, what is digital, what is humanities as a discipline, and what is this digital platform, how they have been used by the stakeholders across the world, how macro analysis as a literary strategy can be used as a critical theory in this digital humanities, in the branch of this new learning. And I also talked about the advantages of digital humanities. And digital humanities too has its limitations. And above all, I still keep saying, knowledge is power, and knowledge shared, knowledge properly shared, is a power multiplied. And it is power multiplied. And I think this video, if it is hosted on the YouTube, this would reach to some 3 lakhs people, to 5 lakhs people. And if they get convinced, and they are empowered, and the knowledge is multiplied, and power is multiplied. So digital humanities is a new form of assertion of knowledge, a new form of assertion of the mass culture. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Prabhakar. I'm so sorry. I said That would be an earthquake when Professor Prabhakar starts speaking. Today it was not an earthquake, no exaggeration, it was a volcanic eruption, a virtual volcanic eruption, a volcanic explosion. And the digital lava was outpouring like anything from that volcanic eruption. Thank you so much, Professor Prabhakar, for enlightening us in this specific new area of study in humanities, digital humanities, the oxymoronic field. Rightly, you started with the advent of the printing press as a medium of liberation. How printing press, the advent of printing press, the invention of the printing press, liberated the sacred text, or rather the knowledge that that had been monopolized by the power centers. So how the printing press liberated, how it humanized, how it disseminated and multiplied text, and how it reached the whole population, the democratization of the hitherto monopolized knowledge systems. You started with that Gutenberg galaxy of Marshall McLuhan, the Canadian, the father of electronic era. And you also quoted very, very rightly from certain statistical sites, statistical data, the worldwide internet usage data. And you repeatedly said that 104 connections per 100 per people in India, and 47% of total connectivity of the world is consumed by Indians, we Indians. So with these information, with these data, and you also said William Shakespeare possesses the 59th position, right? And he stands number one of all the literary figures which we all search in the internet. No doubt Shakespeare should stand number one because we are still reluctant we are still very much insisting on at least a paper on Shakespeare, and hence our students will be naturally searching for Shakespeare and his texts in the search engines of the internet. And we have, as I do agree with you that we cannot escape, or we cannot brush aside the fact that digital humanities is going to be the order of the day. It's not just a question of accepting, it's not just the question of acknowledging the digital humanities, but our concern is only to democratize even digital humanities, because even when you try to justify the Indian consumption of the total connectivity, or the total network consumption, the internet usage, we are really anxious, and we are very much worried about the poorest of the poor. As one of the participants rightly raised a question, out of this 104 connections per 100 people, in rich families and in many sophisticated, even in our own house, we have four mobile phones, but there are people who do not have a single mobile phone. And not only that, we all have mobile phones, but we don't have connectivity. When we started organizing our workshop, I told you already, in the very first day, I was in my bed chamber, very, very comfortably in an air-conditioned room. But towards the end, when I was proposing the vote of thanks, I was literally in the streets, because I could get my connection only in the street. So that much poor connectivity and all such problems do we and our students encounter. We should also look to these issues with regard to digital humanities, I feel. So the equalization part of it, or the humanization part of digital humanities also, I wish you should look into such things also. So it's not just liberating or emancipating, the term which you used towards the end of your lecture. It's not just liberating or emancipating humanity. In the name of emancipating or liberating part of humanity, we should not even think of, or we should not even unwittingly or unconsciously enslave even 3% or 4% or a single percentage of humanity, which is very much lacking the basic infrastructure with regard to the digital world. So with these words, I would like to get into the question and answers. A lot of questions, you know, the chat box is overflooded with a lot of questions. Not one sentence or two sentences, but huge paragraph questions we have. Before getting into the question answer session, I would like to invite our secretary of Mannar Tirumalai Nayakar College, Sri Vijayaraghavan sir, to say a few words, because Sri Vijayaraghavan sir wants to convey his regards to Professor Prabhakar. Sir, please.
Good afternoon, Professor Sivam. Today's session is a wonderful one. A very enlightening one also. You have used the language in a simple manner. That made the session very easy to understand. You clearly analyzed the charges, changes, I think, brought in the field of education from the invention of printing press to mobile phones. For statistical details about the number of mobile users and the internet users all over the world is an eye-opener to all the participants. It is a surprise that is out of 7.75 billion world population, only 50% of the populations are using internet. As mentioned by you, Professor, it is high time all the participants start digitalize their knowledge. And it is also the need of the hour. Because we are passing through the digital era. And thank you, Professor. My hearty congratulations to Dr. Armstrong, Head of Department of English Madras University, Dr. T. Marks, Head English Department of English Pondicherry, and Jayapriya from Kodaikanal University, and Dr. Ramasubbiya, the NAC coordinator of Mannar Tirumalai College, for conducting this informative session today. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Professor Prabhakar, shall we get into the question answer session?
Yes, please.
Yeah. Let me read out the first question from Dr. S. A. Tamimul Ansari. Are we getting trapped in the euphoric images manufactured and propagated by the Silicon Valley, which promises us a false paradise? Why do we choose to ignore the apocalyptic version of digital humanity?
Professor Ansari, you have already made statements and judgments. Professor Ansari is a good friend of mine. And I take all the statements of Ansari as such. I just want to relate Dr. Marks, Dr. the secretary, and my good friend Ansari in a particular plane. Number one, you are all very much concerned about the 53% of non-users of mobile phones. or collectivity. And again, say it is only 53% of accessibility. My dear friends, even after 500 years of this printing technology, the newspapers and all these things, we have still achieved only 63% of literacy. The national literacy rate is only 64%. And if this is the case, that and you have not attained 100% literacy with the books, with the printing technology and other things, and it will slowly pick up. And for your information, right, this is not a story that I'm narrating. And you are all talking about Vision 2023 or Vision 2030. And this Vision 2030 is only the vision of United Nations. That United Nations has given a charter plan of Vision 2030. And in Vision 2030, it has got new educational policies, this NEP, new education policy or national education policies and other things. And in the year 2016, United Nations, it conducted a global conference in Paris on, mind you, please don't ever be carried away by this word, mobile learning, right? Mobile learning. And this mobile learning, the moment that you hear the term mobile learning, you might be rather thrilled, or you might be curious, or you might be even irritant to say, why should I learn through mobile? This mobile learning as a concept of United Nations, developed in 2016, it rather targets the homeless, asylum seekers, refugees of the world. Mobile learning as a strategy to empower, to enlighten the refugees and asylum seekers who do not have any home in the host nation. They want to give them a formal, proper education through mobile. So this was the concept used. So mobile learning, it revolutionizes. And I want you to search, browse the concept of mobile learning, the objective behind mobile learning. It is don't ever be taken by just the word mobile and learning. It is a very, very social exercise, an exercise meant on for the refugees. Similarly, it is not an euphoria. And I remember very well, in The Rivals, Sheridan's Rivals, the protagonist is called Lydia Languish. Right? Lydia Languish. Languish means wasting away. Wasting. And she is wasting away. Lydia is wasting away. In what aspect that she is wasting away? Because Lydia is making use of library. Lydia is making use of books. She is reading. And reading in the Restoration Age. Reading by the women during this Restoration Age was considered a crime, an euphoria, an apocalypse, and the doomsday, perhaps the judgment day. And therefore, Lydia was called languishing, Lydia languish. And same is the experience now, that we are making use of gadgets. We are making use of computers, mobile phones, and other electronic gadgets. We do understand the inadequacy. We do understand that this gadget has not gone to the general public. And people might, right, people, this is how that we need to rather look at from an intellectual perspective or from the perspective of knowledge. A government giving television, right, say they call it free, or they call it no-cost television. When the government is giving no-cost television, we, the academics, we believe that the government is trying to sensitize people. The government is trying to emancipate people by giving a medium which rather propagates, which rather transmits information. But the problem here is, this medium is rather purely taken as a medium of entertainment. We do have Gyan Darshan. We do have news channels. We do have all the information available in the television, which has been given free of cost to the people. TV has not brought any apocalypse. TV has not brought any doomsday to the world. TV has sensitized. Television has emancipated. And television has rather helped people understand the world. And now everyone is talking about corona. Everyone is talking about news. Everyone is talking about the information related to any death. And all possible because of television. Same thing that we want. That is why towards the end of my lecture that I said, we need to ensure the availability of this electronic gadget to all. It is the medium. When it has become the medium, this medium has to be provided, right? Provided to all. There was at the time, the government, Indian government, was planning to sell a computer, a personal computer for 5,000 rupees. And now a mobile is a computer. A mobile is a computer. If it is used properly, a mobile phone can be used as a computer. Any smartphone, right, even a very cheap smartphone can be bought for 2,000 rupees. And these are all possible. But even then, we want the government, right, to ensure infrastructure. This is the order of the day, like railways, like radio, like television, like antennas, right, like towers, that the government has to rather increase the bandwidth of connectivity. The government has to come forward to build infrastructure. The government has to come forward to provide gadgets to the commoners. And in a way that we can very well appreciate the government of Tamil Nadu for giving free laptops to the students taking higher education. This would happen even at the primary level. We will be very happy if the government, if the policymakers come forward to provide this gadget to the other, and by providing a medium. A newspaper is nowadays common. Television is common. Similarly, that we want this electronic gadget and this connectivity common and low price, for which the government has to come forward. And therefore, I would say it is very much practical. It is not an euphoria. It is not rather a far-fetched imagination. And it would not rather bring any apocalypse. This would create a brave new world with internet connectivity. Thank you.
Thank you. We have more questions with regard to the digital divide only. More and more questions related to the same kind of thing.
Excuse me, Dr. Mas.
Yes.
And this, I don't ignore this question. I definitely call this is the limitation.
Yeah.
Books were the limitations. Do you remember some 40 years ago? 40 years ago, books were given, books were distributed free of cost to the students. Students belonging to the underprivileged sections of the society. But similarly, a day might come. We are rather visualizing the day. When this gadget should be.
Sorry to interrupt. I was about to say you answered all those questions. We are close to 1 o'clock, and let us take up just one more question, which is very different from this these questions related to digital divide. It's from Ms. Nibedita, a research scholar, NIT Roorkela. While printing press gave access to knowledge and information to people, digital media has given access to distorted knowledge and information in post-truth age, thereby failing the main purpose of dissemination of knowledge. What is your take on this?
Do you know what is the first daily published from India? This was called Bengal Gazette, the Hikki's Gazette. And this Hikki's Gazette was full of rumors and gossips. And therefore, it was banned later. And don't you have gossips in print media? Don't you have scandals in print media? It is all your individual perception. That is why that I keep telling. This is rather the individual censoring. This is rather the individual editing. The individual, it is the responsibility of the individual to go for the valid statements for the validity of the knowledge. Right, and the best example is Hickey's Gazette. Right, Hickey's Gazette in India. It was full of gossips. It even gossiped about the wife of Viceroy, and therefore it was banned. So this happened to the first ever magazine in India, and same thing is happened. The distortion is not the problem of the medium. It is the problem of the stakeholder. It is the problem of the user. I make use of computers for my information purpose. Somebody might be making use of computers for some other purpose, and somebody maybe might be making use of computers for some explicit images or for some entertainment. It is all individual. Knowledge is very much individual oriented. Right? We cannot rather classify our knowledges, and we cannot just blame the gadget for that. We need to blame the individual for seeking those opposed to truth. If you come to know, if you are very much aware of the fact that this is opposed to truth, this is a distortion of fact, dismiss it. That is my answer.
Thank you, Professor Prabhakar, for the enlightening session. It was really a resourceful and a wonderful session, a wonderful lecture. And today's lecture is yet another eye-opener for many youngsters, many research scholars and faculty members. And it was resourceful and a very, very inspiring talk this morning. Thank you so much, Professor Prabhakar. Thank you for accepting our invite and having come over virtually to deliver this lecture. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Let us be digitally connected. Thank you.
Thank you. Dear participants, we have another inspiring and very, very resourceful lecture this afternoon by Dr. Sikhumbuso Mangadi from the University of Johannesburg, South Africa. He'll be discussing the language debate in South Africa. So please have your lunch and come back sharp 2:45. Thank you so much.
Thank you all.